Session 11, Kubernetes controllers. I'll explain theoretical concept, replication sets, daemon sets, deployments. I'll stop at this point. Replication set, daemon set, and deployments. What are these things? The replication set or replica set ensure that how many replicas of pod should be running. It can be considered as a replacement of replication controller. The difference being that the replication controller only supports equality based selector. Remember, I talked about labels and selectors. So in selector, you can specify equality or set. Remember that in, not equal. So replication controller only supports equality based selector, while replica set supports set based selector, means in, not in. So replica set, for example, two replicas. So this cluster, this pod is ready on this machine, on this node. But this was ready, but now it's saying crashed. The moment the pod on second node get into crashed state, you will see another pod being created on another node. So this means that replica set will always try to enact the changes and will try to maintain the desired state of your pod, how many copies you want. This is how we create the replica set. Let's understand one by one. This is already explained, API version, group, and the version number. So extension V1, the API version is the version 1 of Kubernetes. Number 2 is the kind. Kind is replica set is what we are creating. Replica set helps kubectl to understand that the file is used to create a replica set. Tier is backend. Here, match labels. See, this is what I was talking about, the match labels. So matching label here is the key and the value. Can be anything, donkey, monkey, or the value can be anything. This is the label tier. Backend create a matching selector. So this is the selector with this key. This can be anything. Key tier operation in value backend. This is what is given here. Key is tier operation in value is backend. This is this will help match expression to understand the matching condition we have defined in the operation, which is used to match label to find the details. Replication set. When you create a backend replica set with the provided definitions in the YAML file, it can be represented as this. Kube service, backend replica set, backend replica set, backend replica set. The daemon sets. The daemon set feature is used to ensure that some or all of your pods are scheduled and running on every single available node. Like Kubernetes node 1 daemon set, so pod 1, pod 2. Another daemon set, pod 1, pod 2. This is node 2. This essentially run a copy of the desired pod across all nodes. When a new node is added to the Kubernetes cluster, a new pod will be added to that newly attached node. When a node is removed, the daemon set controller ensures that pod associated with that node is garbage collected. Deleting a daemon set will clean up all the pods and daemon sets are created, that is created. The use cases for daemon sets. Daemon sets can improve the performance by distributing maintenance tasks and support services via deploying pods across all nodes. They are well suited for long running services like monitoring and log collection. Some example, to run a daemon for cluster storage on each node, such as Glustered or Ceph. Or to run a daemon for log collection for each node, such as Fluentd or Logstash. Or third example use case is run a daemon for node monitoring on every node, like Prometheus, Node Exporter, or Grafana, or Collected or Datadog. Depending on the requirement, you can set up multiple daemon sets for single type of daemon with different flags, memory, CPU that supports multiple configuration and hardware types. These are use cases for daemon sets. Scheduling daemon set pods. By default, the node for a pod is decided by the Kubernetes scheduler. However, daemon set pods are created and scheduled by the daemon set controller. Using the daemon set controller can lead to inconsistent pod behavior and issues in pod priority preemption. To mitigate these issues, Kubernetes allow users to schedule daemon set using default scheduler instead of daemon set controller. This is done by adding node affinity term in the daemon set of pod instead of dot spec node name term. Node affinity is what we will be using. The default scheduler is then used to bind the pod to the target host. This is a simple node affinity configuration. This was another answer that can we configure some pods to be running on a specific node still managed by Kubernetes. That can be done using node affinity. So here it is a pod only. This is metadata affinity, node affinity required during scheduling, ignored during exception, node selection terms is, and this is the matching selection for my node. So this will create a pod on the node that has a disk type equal to SSD label. So this is the way we can specify a given pod on a specific node with matching labels. As for every other component in Kubernetes, daemon sets are configured using a YAML file. Let's have a look at the structure of a daemon set file. API version, kind, metadata are required fields in every Kubernetes manifest. So daemon set, metadata, namespace, labels, and these are specifications. The daemon set specific fields come under spec section. These fields are both mandatory. One is the template, second is the selector. So the template is the pod definition for the pod that needs to be deployed across all the nodes. A pod template in a daemon set must have its restart policy set to always, and by default it will take always if you have not specified any restart policy. Selector, the selector for pod managed by the daemon set must be labeled specified in the pod template, like test daemon set container as the selector. This may be fixed also. Changing this value will cause pods created via the daemon set to be orphaned. There are optional fields like under template spec node selector. It is used to specify a subset of nodes that will create the pod matching the specified selector. Then we have template spec affinity. This field can be configured to set the affinity that would run the pod only on node that match the configured affinity. This is another daemon set specification. You can describe the daemon set in a YAML file. For example, this daemon set.yml file here describe a daemon set that run fluently Elasticsearch Docker image. This is for reference only. Kind of daemon set specification, selector, the template, and the specifications, and the containers. Deployments in Kubernetes let you manage a set of identical pods through a single parent object. Again, hierarchy one level above replica sets. So if you look at the hierarchy, we have containers, then we have pods, then we have replica sets, and then we have deployments. If you have a pod that you want many copies of, say an application server that need to scale up with increased load, then deployments are the right tool for you. That let you create that pod so that it can be replicated, updated without downtime, and number of copies scaled up. Through configuration YAML, you tell Kubernetes the number of copies of a pod you want running. If a pod fails, a node dies, or you increase the number of copies, then Kubernetes will work to make the deployment match your declared ideal state. As a developer, having Kubernetes manage the scaling and replication of your web app is probably the main appeal of the deployments. Behind the scenes, deployment leverages another object called replica set. Few slides back we discussed that. Best practices is what we don't directly manage replica sets. Deployment manage that. That is why there will be no specific lab and not required that you learn replica set separately. Think of deployment as managing replica sets and replica sets managing at pods. Put them all together and you got a great way to deploy and manage applications on Kubernetes. To start with, you can. This is a simple command line creation, but this is not the ideal way to create. However, this is the simplest possible way, the minimum command to create a deployment. Kubectl run Nginx deployment, images Nginx, replicas 3. This command tell Kubernetes that we want a deployment called Nginx deployment to run the Nginx Docker image and that we want this happen on 3 pods. Deployment for rolling updates and rollbacks. Replica set, self-healing scalability, pods, the logical unit containing containers. We can then query the state of deployment, kubectl get deployment, Nginx deployment. In the output, notice the desired current and available columns. If any of these contain different numbers, the Kubernetes will enact changes to reconcile the current state with the desired state. So when you say in the deployment, you declare that I want 3 Nginx pods. Then a replica set will create 3 copies of that. So you will say you will get a pod, 3 pods running all with Nginx application web server. Simulate pod failing. Now you can simulate the application pod failing. Watch the Kubernetes deployment created a new pod in its place immediately. So you can run these commands, kubectl get pods, delete pod, any pod ID, and then get pod. You will see that immediately it will you see that one pod being created. After we killed the pod, a new pod was immediately scheduled by Kubernetes with a container creating status. After a few seconds, terminating pod was completely removed and new pod is there in place in its place. The new pod is ready and moved into the running status. Our deployment has automatically reconciled with the actual system state with the desired state we declared to Kubernetes when we created the deployment. That is what the deployment is. Very easy concept. Let's understand through this file and I'll go line by line with indentation explained properly. In Kubernetes, you declare your desired system state through configuration file which can be tracked, versioned and easily understood. So like pod deployment are declared through YML files. Create a deployment.yml file in your system path with this code. Let's understand this code line by line. At the top, we specify the API version to use, repeating the same thing again and again. API version apps v1. If we are using an up-to-date version, deployment objects are created into apps v1 API group. That's why we created this. Color coding is done so that you focus on that line in that color. Dot kind means the second level. Dot is the root level, I mean the top level. So dot kind means we are talking about the top level element kind. So indentation has to be at the same level. This is what you are learning indentation also with this representation. It tells that we are creating a deployment. Then dot metadata again at the top level, same indentation level, is where we give the deployment a name and labels. This is what we are giving. Name is deployment and we are not giving any labels here. Then the spec section is where the maximum action happens, where most of the action happens. Spec. So all other are under spec. So this indentation, all the elements here are under this level. So spec is outside. This is another level. So understand that there's nothing now at spec level. Spec is the fourth element. There's no other element at the top level. Now under this spec, anything directly below sec, below spec, directly below spec, specification is replica, selector, minimum, strategy, template. So we have these 5 elements directly below spec are related to pod. That means about 10 replicas of the pod. This is the selector for pod. Minimum relay second ready second is 10. This is pod. Strategy for pod. Template for the pod. All these are features of the pod. Then if you at the pod level, anything nested below dot spec dot template dot spec, meaning we are under template, under that there's another spec. So this spec is under template. Watch the indentation carefully, team. So this is under a template. So this spec is related to the container. This is the container detail. So under spec, then we have template. Under template, we have another spec. That spec is for the containers. That means the deployment properties, the pod properties are created at the spec level under spec. And the container properties are specified under spec within template. So at the pod level, spec replicas, pod level spec replicas, meaning this one, first entry. Tells Kubernetes how many pod replicas for this deployment you want to create. Spec selector, this one, is the matching label, list of labels the pod must have in order for the deployment to manage them. So pod label selectors are given here. So that means when we will be creating pod, we have to have these labels, because this is the selector and this is the label. You see, this has to match. So selector is match label app hello world. We have to have app and hello world here. That's why this deployment will be able to manage it. Spec selector, list of labels. Spec strategy, this one, red color, tells Kubernetes how to perform updates on the deployment. It is a rolling update, maximum unavailable one, maximum surge one. I'll explain that. Another value of interest is minimum ready seconds, this one, in the same file. This is set to 10, telling Kubernetes to wait for 10 seconds between each individual pod being updated. This is useful for throttling the rate at which update occur. Longer waits gives us a chance to spot problems and avoid situation where we update all pods to a faulty configuration. So this is minimum ready seconds. Now you can deploy it. Kubectl apply hyphen app. Deployment is now instantiated on the cluster. We can use the usual kubectl get command and kubectl describe command to see the details of the deployment. Get deploy, hello deploy, describe deploy, hello deploy. All these commands can be checked. And you will see all these replicas available. These are screen grab for your reference. Deployments automatically created associated with replica sets. Use this command to confirm this. Kubectl get replica set or RS. Remember, this short form is applicable for even NS, like NS for namespaces, RS for replica sets. And this will give you 10 desired, 10 current, ready is 10, and age is 2 minutes, 50 seconds. Accessing the app. To access the application, we need a Kubernetes service object, because without service, you will not be able to interact with the application. If you need to know, all you need to know is that Kubernetes services provide a stable DNS name and IP address for a set of pods. So this is the service we are creating. Please remember that this service has to address the given pods. The matching label has to be the same, app hello world. Ensure that this has to be the same. So we are creating a file for services, that is svc.yml. And in this file, important point about the service are given here. Type is node port. We'll discuss, we have a comprehensive session on services. But to summarize, node port means you can access this port from any worker node, from anywhere, using the port number 8080. Node port is 3001, sorry. So port is 8080. This will be where the this container is listening on, and a node port where it will be available on the node of your cluster. Protocol TCP and selector, again the label selector. So from the service is deployed, you can access it from inside the cluster using DNS name hello svc on port number 8080, from outside the cluster by hitting any of the cluster node on port number 3001. That's what, how do you access the pod. Now you see the complete cycle is now complete. We learned containers, how to create containers. We understood pods, how to create and manage pods. Briefly, we discussed a replica set because we are not going to directly manage them. Deployments will take care of that. And the outermost element now, what we discussed is just now finished, is almost is the deployments, where the deployments manage replica sets, which ensure that multiple copies or replicas of an application running, which is running in the pod, and the rest of the details. To access the pod, to access that application, we need a service. Rolling updates and rolling back. Other than providing seamless replication and a declarative system states, using deployments gives you the ability to update your application with zero downtime and track multiple versions of your deployment environment. When a deployment configuration changes, for example, by updating the image used by its pods, Kubernetes detects this change and executes steps to reconcile the system state with the configuration changes. The mechanism by which Kubernetes executes this update is determined by the strategy type field. The strategy type can be recreate, it can be rolling update. When we say recreate, I'm talking about strategy.type, meaning under strategy type. Let's go back to our example. This was our example. I am referring to this point now, type. This is strategy, under that we have type. So rolling update. What all possible values we have for this type? I am talking about this now. That's why I am writing dot strategy dot type. So recreate, this can be recreate also. With recreate strategy, all running pod in the deployment will be killed and new pods will be created in their place. This does not guarantee zero downtime, but can be useful in case you are not able to have multiple versions of your application running simultaneously. Then we have rolling update. This is preferred and more commonly used strategy is rolling update. This gracefully update pods one at a time to prevent your application from going down. The strategy gradually brings pod with a new configuration online while killing old pods as the new configuration scales up. When updating your deployment with rolling updates, there are two useful fields you can configure. One is maximum unavailable, second is maximum surge, which was given. Let's look at that. We configured maximum unavailable, maximum surge, and we are configuring this. Maximum unavailable, maximum surge. So we are understanding these two fields. Maximum unavailable effectively determines the minimum number of pods you want running in your deployment as it updates. For example, if you want a deployment currently running 10 pods and maximum unavailable value is 4, that means Kubernetes, when the update is triggered, Kubernetes will immediately kill 4 pods because you are saying maximum unavailable 4. So it will kill 4 pods, bringing the total to 6. Kubernetes will then start bring up the new pods and then kill old pods as they come alive. Eventually, deployment will have 10 replicas of the pods, but at no point during the update were there fewer than 6 pods available. Then there was another value, that was maximum surge. That determines maximum number of pods you want running in your deployment as it updates. For example, if you specify the maximum surge of 3, Kubernetes could immediately create 3 copies of the new pods, bring total to 13, and then begin killing the old version. So that is maximum surge. When you want to update, probably you specify maximum surge also 1 or 2, so that your availability is not affected. Rolling back, deployment's entire rollout and configuration history is tracked in Kubernetes, allowing for powerful undo and redo functionality. You can easily roll back to a previous version of your deployment at any time. This is managed through kubectl rollout command, which is easy to use and has self-explanatory commands. The command line help information for this command is quite good, and previous it provides useful examples. We can access it via kubectl rollout hyphen hyphen help using rolling update and rolling back. So we are creating one deployment here, kind is deployment, replicas 5, strategy rolling update, rolling update, maximum search 2, maximum unavailable 1, selector match label nginx, and the template is about the container, and this is the container, sorry, this one is the container. So here we have a simple deployment that has 5 pods running nginx 1.7.9 because we are giving the image version also. Now create deployment and check out the deployment version revision log using kubectl rollout. So kubectl apply hyphen f deployment, then rollout history deployment. We can see that first version of our deployment has been deployed and rolled out. Now let's update our deployment to use more modern version of nginx, say 1.15. Then watch the Kubernetes scale down the old replicas of the pod and bring online replicas of the pod that has updated version of nginx. Apply updated copy, rollout history deployment, get deployment, and then you will say, check the status also of the deployment. But what if we discover this new version has problem? Then you have to go to the revision, old update. Obviously you would want that. We should perform a rollback to restore the last version of deployment. Kubectl rollout make it simple to inspect your deployment history and to roll back to the previous version. So you run this kubectl rollout history deployment, it'll give you the history. Then you want to go back to revision 2 or revision 1 or whatever, you can specify that revision. So history, rollout history, rollout history, and you can do undo also, you can go back to which version you want to go back. Scaling and auto scaling. Kubernetes makes adjusting the number of replicas in your deployment easy. You can scale a deployment manually using kubectl or automatically based on resource usage with horizontal pod autoscaler resource. We have a dedicated session on HPA, quick session, but this is a brief summary. This is manual scaling, first we are understanding. To manually scale the previous deployment to 8 replicas, use the kubectl scale command. Kubectl scale deployment and replicas 8. And then check the history, get deployments to confirm this. Autoscaler, HPA, horizontal pod autoscaler, require a dedicated session. So it will be discussed in a separate session also. But right now, we just know the basics of it. It's a new resource in modern version of Kubernetes that manages the number of replicas in your deployment automatically. The autoscaler automatically scales the number of pods based on resource utilization. This was originally limited to tracking CPU, but now it is based on memory usage also and custom metrics also, in fact. A common use case is to scale pod based on the number of items in a work queue. Autoscaling is an advanced new feature whose configuration settings are changing quickly, so anything written here in this session is likely to be outdated. So we have to keep a track on it. When researching online, also take into account your production Kubernetes cluster version. The autoscaling features available to you might be different than what you expect. That's all for this session. Let's take a look at the example given in this session. Let me just give one example so that we can proceed further after that. So I'm creating this deployment, but important point for me is I don't want extra baggage, so I'm just removing the comments. DD. So this will delete the line. So this is the real deployment what we were talking about, where we have app nginx and version 7.9. Let's apply it. Kubectl apply hyphen f deployment. Let me check kubectl get pods hyphen o wide all namespaces. Oh no, it will not work. Remember, you forgot. I'm sorry, I forgot. I have to remove my dot kube directory. Remember that last Kubernetes was the Kubernetes on OCI. So I have to move this mv kube to dot kube. That was the problem. So sorry, so sorry. Now this is fine. Now it will deploy it. Yes, now if I deploy, it will work. Kubectl. Let me change the default this also. Yes, there is one more change. Good one. That's what the good point is. This v beta 1 is now v2. It is there is no version 1. I mean no beta 1. You simply use v1. This is also correction. Yes, v1. Now I deploy it. What happened? Extension v1. Okay, let me see if it is v2. One second. This is quite common. If there is a things are changing, then we have to apply that. So what is that extension v2? Where is the deployment then? Second, I will get it. So we change it, apps and v1. In fact, you don't need to type the group name also. Why not API version apps slash v1? Good. Yes. So it has to be app slash v1. So revision change still is going on, I believe. Let me check. Yeah, it is still creating the containers. It's not ready. It has to create 5. Remember, what was that? Oh, well, that was yesterday. You recollect that I demonstrated Kubernetes on OCI, and I moved my old dot kube directory to backup kube. And then I recreated dot kube to access my OCI Kubernetes cluster. Remember that? Eventually, I terminated that. So the dot kube directory became irrelevant. So to access my current cluster, I had to move my kube directory back to dot kube. Got it? Yeah. So I think still creating. Oh, it is running. Perfect. It should be. So deployment. Let's make it 1.15. 15.0 and apply the same file configured. Now you see the history also. Now it is creating new container and old containers are running as it is. So now see the whole rollout history. So ready 4 out of 5, up to date 3, available 4. And I can see waiting for deployment Nginx, rollout to finish. 2 old replicas are pending termination. 1 old is pending termination. 4 of pending update are available. Oh, finally successfully rolled out. So this command is to be immediately executed so that you can watch the things happening. So this is what exactly what you have done. The copy, what you have done, scale up, scale down, configuration changes. See the history will be 2 revisions we have done. Revision 1 and 2. Rollout history, deployment, revision equal to 2. So this is the revision 2, label container, and so image is changed. If I see the same thing for revision 1, you will see the image is different. So this is how you can investigate which revision has what image. So you can actually investigate the changes you have done in subsequent deployments, subsequent revisions. You can see that 2 revisions are listed here. Revision 1 have 1.7.9 and revision 2 have 1.15. So rolled back. Now if you see, you will see the status, some pods being terminated and some being created. So new being terminated and old one being restored back. So you will see that same thing. So if you see rollout history, you will see revision number 3, because the 1 is undone now. So 1 has become 3 now. So if you check that revision number 3, you will see history replica number 3. So now you see it is using 1.7.9, because that is undone part. Revision 1 was undone. So that's how the rollout and rollback can be done using Kubernetes. All right, that's all for this session.